Hey guys, so today me and Mark are at the world famous Glute Lab here with the man himself, Bret Contreras, and we are going to do a bit of a Q&A on all things glutes.
So I trained Lauren when she became the WBFF World Bikini Champion, and a whole lot of the stuff I used on Lauren's bikini body, I learned from Bret. So Bret is the man when it comes to all things glutes.
So first question, which is probably going to be one of the most common, is what are three tips that you can give for the people out there on growing their glutes?
Okay, so my first tip that I would give for glute training is you have to train the glutes like a couple times a week, usually like three times a week, say. If you train in glutes, like a lot of women, for example, will do what they're boyfriends taught them to do, and they'll do a body part split, and they're doing like a chest day, a leg day, a shoulder day, a back day, an arm day, and they're training glutes one day a week. So if you're doing that, you have so much gains to be made just by increasing your glute training frequency. In my opinion, you should be training like full body or an upper lower split, or at least if you do a body part split, do a hamstring day, but throw in glute exercise, like stiff leg deadlifts and back extensions work hamstrings and glutes. Do a quad day where you do like squats and lunges, they work glutes, and then do a dedicated glute day where you do a bunch of hip thrusts and abduction stuff. Second tip is find the variations that work best for you. So, we just finished off a training session, and my job is to help Lauren figure out the stances and postures and variations that work best for her. Some people like band hip thrusts more than barbell. Some people like frog pumps, some people don't. Some people love cable kickbacks. Some people feel their glutes with back extensions, some people don't. But I promise you, there's a type of squat that you do feel in your glutes. There's a type of deadlift or hip hinge that you do feel in your glutes. There's a type of hip thrust or bridge variation that you do feel in the glutes. And it's your job to figure that out, because we can't be everywhere training everyone. So you have to take that upon yourself to learn. And then the third tip I would say is there's this volume obsession lately I see it so much with like the people I design programs for. They want to be training glutes 6 days a week with like 30 sets a day. And like you're going to do 180 sets of glutes a week. The research suggests that 10 to 20 sets a week is optimal. I think the glutes can handle more than that. So here at Glute Lab, we tend to do around 35 sets per week. But there's a system to it. We don't do 35 sets of heavy walking lunges a week, or just squats, deadlifts, and lunges. That would crush you. We do a mixture of vertically loaded exercise like squats and lunges, horizontally loaded exercises like hip thrusts and glute bridges and back extensions, and then lateral work, which isn't as taxing, so that's how we get away with doing that much volume. So those would be my three tips.
Awesome. All right, so what I'm going to ask Bret is about frequency. So does your frequency for training the glutes change for the level of client? If it's a beginner, intermediate, advanced, what do you think is optimal frequency all up for the glutes?
Okay, this is probably the question I get asked most often, and the short answer is three times a week for everyone. The longer answer is, okay, I had one client that I trained back in the day, her name was Sammy. I have her before and after stage pictures, I think we doubled the size of her glutes. But I quickly realized that she got so strong, she was super strong, but I trained her on Mondays and Thursdays, trained her twice a week, and on Thursdays she was so beat up, she'd be so weak. So I was like, okay, I'm gonna decrease her volume. I'm gonna decrease. It got to a point where I have her do one set of six exercises twice a week. So she's doing 12 total sets a week, but she was so strong, that's all she could recover from. So here I've her doing 2 days a week, one set of six exercises, and her glutes grew like crazy. Now I have another client named Erin. She heard me interview Natalia Mello back in the day when she won Miss Bikini Olympia, and she's Brazilian. She's like, in Brazil, we train glutes every day. They do some glutes every day, but it's not this like you know, like how you might work out when you're training for powerlifting, like 5x5 with progressive overload. It's like they just pick a few exercises and do a few sets, really for high reps with a mind-muscle connection. It's not for progressive overload. So anyway, she took it upon herself to start doing band training every day. She did like 5 to 60 minutes of bands 6 days a week. She didn't do a lot of barbell stuff and a lot of, she only did seated hip abduction machine and also hip thrust off like the leg extension machine and then all band work. And her glutes, like, I swear they doubled in size. I have her before and after pictures too. She looked so different. And she was probably doing 30 sets, but they're not to failure. Band exercises don't work you in a big stretch. They only work you in the shortened positions. They don't create a lot of muscle damage. And so here's two different extremes showing great results. If you do really heavy, hard exercise that tax you a lot, like think of dumbbell walking lunges where you're just crushing yourself, or heavy squats, heavy deadlifts, you can do less volume. If you do exercises that work you mostly in the shortened length position, like glute bridges and hip thrusts and lateral band work, you can do more sets and you can train more often. The shorter answer is 3. The long answer is anywhere from 2 to 6 days a week, depending on your exercise selection and then also depending on your own genetics. So there's a review paper that came out reviewing the genetics of muscle damage, and some people experience way more muscle damage than others. And also there's like a recovery gene that they found. Some people just recover quicker than others. So depending on this, so that's just depending on you. And you learn that when you train people. And again, we can't be everywhere, so you got to learn this yourself. What is your optimal frequency based on the exercise you like to do and how you like to train? It might be 2 days a week. It might be 6 days a week. But 3 being the most basic answer to that question that works well for the masses.
But it depends.
So a lot of girls come to me, they train their glutes, but they don't feel them because they're so quad dominant, they're so hamstring dominant, so they really struggle to feel that glute mind muscle connection and things like that. So what would be your advice to someone that is quad dominant or hamstring dominant to best feel their glutes?
Okay. So like there's always tips you can do. For example, if you throw mini bands or a hip circle or a glute loop or whatever band you have. You have your own bands?
I do.
What are they called?
Lauren Simpson bands.
If you have your Lauren Simpson bands and you throw those around right above your knees when you do glute bridges or hip thrusts or squats, you're going to feel your glutes more because I call it torque doubling. You're carrying out hip extension, but now you're having to carry out hip abduction just to push it to prevent the knees from caving in. So that's one such tip. But they're always, when I work with people, for example, let's say they're like, I feel my quads too much in a hip thrust, or I feel hip thrusts all in my hamstrings. I will work with their stance, how far their feet are away from their butt, how wide their stance is, their foot flare. I will play around with band resistance or dumbbells or barbells. I'll play around with their posture, whether they come up and look up, whether they look forward, whether they're pelvic tilting more or just pushing the hips as high as they can. I play around with all sorts of things with posture and things like that. And I also with how high the bench is. Sometimes if the bench is too high, you feel it most in your quads. And like if you do glute bridges, you tend to not feel as much in your quads. And You can elevate the feet. You can do all sorts of things. You can do pauses, lighter weights for higher reps, focusing on more on quality. But there's always a solution. And everyone I work with, I can find something that works well for them. There's so many variations, but that's what you have to learn what to even experiment with. And that I was just talking about hip thrust. There's also similar strategies you can use with squats and deadlifts. And maybe you don't like barbell back squats, but you feel goblet squats working your glutes very well. One thing I learned when I used to do so much EMG experimentation, I would take all my clients and hook them up to electrodes and have them do like 50 exercises. And it's different for every person. The client I told you about, Sammy, she got way higher glute activation with 50 pound goblet squats compared to 205 pound back squats. Mm. And she also got way higher with kettlebell deadlifts than with heavy barbell deadlifts. That was just her. It seemed when the weight was more centered and more like in the front of her body there, she got better results. But that's not true for everyone. Everyone is different. And with you work with a lot of people, you realize that there's you don't make black and white statements. Everything's in shades of gray and it always depends. But you got to tinker. You got to learn how to vary them. And you need to know a lot of different exercises. You know, some people, their favorite glute exercise is a cable kickback. Some people hate the cable kickback. It just depends. Yeah. And you will find it if you tinker around enough. You'll find exercises that work well for your body.
Awesome.
Perfect.
All right, so the final question. Now, with so many, I guess, women around the world training glutes, what would you say is the biggest mistakes, though, people make with glutes?
Okay, so I knew this question was coming, so I've got a list. I wanted to leave no...
He comes prepared.
I wanted to leave no stone left unturned. So the number one mistake, and I've never seen a woman that naturally does this. They're usually listening to a male... authority figure in strength and conditioning. It's just squatting, and it's the weirdest thing. I have never seen someone doing tricep extension, and some dude's like, just bench. Don't do those stupid tricep extensions. I've never seen someone doing curls, and a guy comes up and goes, just chin up. If you do lateral raise, they don't go, stop doing that stupid crap and just military press. Even if you're doing leg extensions, they don't come up and go, just squat. Or like leg curls, just stiff leg deadlift. But for some weird reason with glutes, I see it all the time. Someone will be doing like a hip thrust or an abduction movement or a kickback or something, and there'll be a male, usually a power lifter, and he's like, just squat. You want nice glutes, just squat. And it's the worst advice. I do seminars, I'll pull my audience and I'll say, how many of you feel like your glutes are the limiting factor in a squat? No one's hands go up. I'm not saying the squat isn't a great glute exercise. It is. You should squat. But you should also hip thrust and hip hinge and do a single leg movement and do abduction work. You need to do a variety. So for all those people who say just squat, what I want to say to them is look at the people with the top 20 women with the nicest glute development over the world. They're all doing 10 or 20 different glute exercises. None of them just squat. So that's just, and no bodybuilder just does one exercise for a body part. So that's the worst advice. Okay. Also, training glutes just one day a week, which we already addressed. You should train glutes 3 days a week, but 2 to 6 works depending. Okay. Not doing anything for the upper glutes. So if you do mostly squats, lunges, deadlifts, those work the lower glutes more. You need to be doing hip thrusts and back extensions, work the upper and lower glutes, but frontal plane hip abduction, like when you're standing doing lateral band work with your Lauren Simpson bands, or you're doing like side-lying hip abductions. We did extra range side-lying hip abductions today. Those work mostly your upper glutes. Not just that people think upper glutes means glute medius. No, there's two main subdivisions of the gluteus maximus, the upper and lower. Those work the upper subdivision more. Not doing any horizontal-based hip extension exercises. You need to be doing hip thrusts and getting good at them if you want your, and not just hip thrusts, but back extensions, kickbacks. These work your glutes at end range, and that's the zone that maximizes glute activation. If you have EM electrodes hooked up to your glutes, you can't maximally activate your glutes in a flex position. It's at end range, shortened positions. And then thinking cardio will yield good glute development. I see this all the time where
girls do kickbacks on the car.
Yeah, they're doing Stairmaster with the kickbacks, and they think that it...
I'll probably do a workout video with that.
She's done that.
Yeah. That, you feel your glute, but it's so many repetitions. It's just working type 1. You're not going to build muscle mass that way. I don't think if you train the way that Lauren does or the way that Mark programs or the way that I program, I don't believe that cardio brings anything to the table with an already good existing program. Cardio won't help with glute development. It can help with fat loss, but not with glute development. And then getting injured by engaging in high-risk activities like sprinting and plyos without properly preparing yourself. So I always say this. Mark, would you ever go 2 years without lifting and then walk right in the gym and do a 1 rep max deadlift?
No, not normally.
Yeah, but you would go 2 years without sprinting and go to the track and do like 800 meter sprints at max capacity And the next day, if you've ever done that, gone 2 years without sprinting and then went to the track and just ran like Forest, you know, like you feel like you've been caned the next day. You feel like you got beat with a bat. Your hip flexors, your hamstrings, your calves. And I've known people who strained a muscle from sprinting. I'm not saying you shouldn't sprint if you enjoy it. Just make sure you're adequately prepared. But even so, plyos and sprinting, people go, sprinters have great glutes. Look at sprinters' glutes before weight training was popular. Sprinters' glutes come from weight training, not as much from sprinting. But the plyos and sprinting, it's too rapid to maximize tension in the muscle. It's too fast of a contraction. You can get high activation, but it's too quick for the muscle to generate max tension, so it's not the best glute builder weight training is. But if you do those things, make sure you prepare. And it's really hard to be like, okay, sprint at 60% of max for like day one and then go to 70. It's hard to do it, but you got to ease. But you could just do 10-meter sprints all out and then move the distance up over time. But plyos and stuff, you can hurt yourself. You got to be work your way into those. And the last one is there's no fun or buy-in. If you said, hey, Mark, here's your program for the next 10 years. You're doing 5x5 squats and deadlifts and bench and chin-ups. After like a year, you'd be so bored, you'd hate it.
4 weeks.
4 weeks, you'd hate it.
One week.
I'd be done. You have to keep vary your training. Now, variety is good for preventing staleness, but I think it's also just good for your psychological edge,
exactly.
Like thinking like, oh, this new program and being excited about it. So if I'm friends with all the guys who know the most about hypertrophy, but even so, if say one minute rest times gave you the best results, they don't, I wouldn't do that because I hate 1 minute rest. I like resting 3 minutes. I take my time, but guess what? I've lifted weights for 27 years. And I know what works best for me. I hate doing, you know, heavy kettlebell swings make me want to die. I can do my 203 pounder for 30 reps and then I feel like dying. So I don't do it. I do what I enjoy doing and then I can train week in and week out for years. So make sure you enjoy your training. So those are the 7 main mistakes.
All right, well, I think that's about it. Thank you so much, Bret, for having us. We have
Thank
had
you.
Such an awesome time here, and yeah. Thank you guys for watching today's video. I hope that you took something away from this. And if you're new to my channel, please make sure that you hit subscribe, but we will see you again on the next video.